current mother. I was about two and a bit, and I just started drawing. And they were quite worried in the family because we hadn't had artists in the family before. They were all engineers and stevedores and things. But yeah, I mean, I started very early, and I suppose that with a pretty good level of drawing, by the time I was about 10, very popular at school. Everybody wants you to draw planes and tanks and things. And, but one thing I did well, I think just by myself, very early on, was to do like three-dimensional stuff. You know, most, well, all children will start off and draw flat. You know, it's the same as playing the rooms, but not. Well, I suppose when I was about 10, I was drawing three-dimensional, which impressed the art teacher, who suggested, I suppose, at the time that I should go into art, but I knew better than everybody else at the time, so I didn't do it. I just assumed that everybody drew. I've said that before, and it was it wasn't until many years later that I realised that I've quite a good talent for it. It's actually the French that convinced me. Lots of drinking sausage, and they said, yeah, you can draw. I said, that's coming from them. I suppose I better do a dread. So, you mentioned about a process, but I suppose I kind of go through the process, but I tend to kind of draw straight off. Well, that's not true, because no, I do sometimes, if I'm completely enjoying what I've just read about a scene, I'll kind of break it down, but let's see. I always remember Dave Gibbons being here, and he was showing a class how the whole body, you know, tubes and things. So I suppose I kind of do that. It's not. This is another thing, by the way. I work in a solitary environment. I don't sit and talk to myself when I'm in the morning. So this might sound maybe quite interesting. we'll do it.
Is there any particular pencils you prefer?
Not really, no. I like these mechanical pencils, but I also enjoy working with them. Those Dutch pencils I used to find they were good for just for drawing and doing heavy lead stuff. Yeah, and most of the stuff I've done, Light and Darkness, and Star Wars, I discovered about 20 years ago, inks, acrylic inks, waterproof acrylic inks called Rotring. Look at little hand grenades at the bottom. And I find them very good to work with because you can put down a colour and then you can let it dry and then you can work over it without it moving, you know. It was when I came back from France in 1978 and I had to get a bit of work. So in France, I've really been painting. I did things on back to the ground. You know, people do comics and then they get on a bit and they say they'd like to be a painter. Well, I was painting and then I did a comic. That was through a pal of mine in Glasgow. In the, I used to work in PR and art studio there when I was still. And I'd been away somewhere, I couldn't remember to London, but I came back and I met up with him. And I said, what are you up to? He said, I'm still doing the commercial art. He was a really good painter. And he said, I was trying that comics thing. I said, what was that? Because I had no idea about comics. He's not really engrossed in painting. Also, I never realised when I was a little boy, you know, looking at comics, people actually sat down and drew them. I thought it was just a big machine in a hand. It just all flowed out, and people cut them to sizes, put staples in them, and free gifts. And so I don't know what to do. So this character, Dredd, is, well, for me as an artist, he's just such an enjoyable character to do. Because there are bits when you're drawing, you can actually cheat a little bit. And you'll no doubt, if any of you are familiar with Dredd, you'll know that lots of artists have their own version. A lot of artists, I must say mainly young ones, have also, they try to change it too quick. You know, and I can understand that. You know, you get a chance to draw an established character, so you think, well, I need to leave a mark on it. But if you're thinking, don't, just, the character is established. People love him. It sells well, it makes money. And so that's one of the problems you see a lot of youngsters mostly not for the media. Well, I mean, I'm a real sucker for John Wagner and Alan Grant scripts. Because you can just say that they let me run riot with the characters. Also, it allows you. I suppose you get a chance to be quite a bit of a caricature when you do a lot of Dredd characters, you know, the, what they call the freaks and people from the Ragalans. No, that's an excellent game, that's really good. And great guys to work with, John. Because I'm a great believer in pencil. I think a pencil illustration in comics, pencil, if you do them the way I do them, that's really very pure, because that's spontaneous art. Functional art is the rest that I do by inkers. And then a hand colour of ink, black ink. So that becomes, it's a wee bit, not tedious, it's quite exciting sometimes, seeing what happens with your colours. Especially when I did Star Wars, that was interesting. But you know, I'm a great believer in pencil drawings. If you can do the pencil drawings, you can do anything.
Well, I don't like the trumpet.
Sometimes it comes out because you can't be bothered to clean your palate. And that you work with what you've got on your job. You work with what you've got. But I'll tell you a story about Star Wars. I must have been on maybe my fifth issue. And we're at an American con, and a little kid, no doubt called Andy, came up and he said, the one problem you got with Star Wars, I said, what's that? He said, you haven't put any stars in the sky. Never had. This isn't. Anyway, after that, I started doing a few stars. I explained it to him by saying that, well, you see, have you ever been out here in this place? He said, no. I said, well, yes. There's bits of the space where you don't see any stars because it's so immense. And he said to me, I can get a handle on that. And I thought, that's good. You know, you know, can you do it? Well, it's not the one can you use, so everybody in the same time. Unless you're hospitalized them in the jail. No, it's so, who said you asked that? Do you really want me to ask to say something about can you?
You're about your trip. The language barrier.
With Danny O'Neill. So, what you mean?
That's what I've heard, yeah.
Well, this is fun. I mean, we're not just trying to No, the Kenny Who came about because John Allen and I, and we were talking on the phone. Or we would, I can't remember one of the comments. And John said, well, we need to get something in the American market because so many other people are doing it. We're going towards America. Mainly because you've got royalties. See, this is kind of thing you need to get royalties. So, the two of my kids, the John Allen, so they're great, but it's got a story to tell us. And then the own inevitable way they come on this story called The Outcast. And the Jolly Cast. We can do some of the characters, trying, etc., etc. So we're going to pitch this at DC Comics. And we're going to have a pitch with Daniel Neal. And so I did some characters, sketches, and a couple of promo pages and sent it off. At that time, we didn't have Facebook and mobile and things. So, we went off to DC Comics, and then we waited. And the only way to get in touch with DC was by telephone. So I left that up to John Allen. They phoned DC and, yeah, sure, we didn't guys get your contract at the end of this. Anyway, what it is, well, John Allen said, one of us has got to go to America. So Sparky, the boy, went up here. Whoever the furthest away was chosen to go to America, to go to DC Comics and ask them, there and then, can we have a contract, please? And that's what I did. I was chosen. I think it was right. Well, the thing you'll have to do is remember that underneath there is a body. You know, sometimes people are over here and the island comes down here.
So, you just always remember that there's a human over here. So, it's not stone. It's not the best. Anyone else have any questions?
I haven't finished talking yet. <about. laughs>
Yeah. Sorry, parents are listening
to you. See, you
very quick one. Okay. Went to the DC offices and I was in the corridor and I said, Daniel, you know someone to sit down there. And I was walking down, this guy was coming to me. She's standing in front of the column, taking flat time, trying to do the kill. To some of you, like.
Anyway, he, I stopped him and I said,
and when I told Jordan Allen the story, they came up with candy. Oh, well, vehicles, yeah, because when I did work with DC Thompson, you know, I suppose to keep really true to the storyline and the time, like that, then we'd have somebody who went to the archives. I would look at trucks and planes and most everything, and they could see that an illustrator would read in the story, and it was a great help, really good help. Dredd, you don't need refs because it just all comes out of your head. Dark Empire, well, yeah, because my family were people who had it before, but somebody, I can't remember writing. Anyway, so you take on Star Wars, you never tried to draw the Millennium Falcon. And I thought, well, it's been designed by somebody. So it must be a kit. So all you've got to do is break it back down into its elements, see how the original guy looked at it, and then put it back together. And it ended up, I enjoyed doing the Falcon because it was a fun vehicle to do, but I got fed up with the other characters and Star Wars. And that's so, shocking. So I mean, that's how Boba Fett came about working with John, because when I was in San Diego one time, and they were expecting me to the thought. I came by a three and I said, I'm not doing any further with that. So they said, oh, I said, nothing you want to do in the Star Wars universe. I said, well, the only thing, the only character that interests me is the bounty hunter, Boba Fett. And they said, oh. So I think she must have phoned Lucas that night, or somebody in Lucas saw. Because of the mystery, she said, that's a gore. We do, you know, do this with. Because I said, we look 4 or 5 days in the life of a bounty hunter. We can bring in all sorts of characters and wreckage and dirt and grain. And she said, you've got to go ahead. She said, well, you write it. And I said, no, John Mike, not going. John Mike, at this point, I've never seen Star Wars. Yeah. And I never seen it because I've been living in France, and in 77 I was in France, and in 77 I was with Star Wars Connect. And I didn't have the slightest interest in Star Wars. I was more into appreciating the French way of life, birds and wine and smoked sausage. So I did what John ended up doing, and it's got. Oh, very good success at the time. Young people like you, so it's a video cassette. Anyway, watched the video cassette, got enough breath from that, and took it from there. When I phoned John, I was in America, in America at the time. phoned up John and said, I got you a graphic novel to do Boba Fett. So John said, Boba Fett. And I told him, oh. And John got the three cassettes, the three films, and I think within 6 days, there was a synopsis on Lucasfilm's desk. He just nearly just rattles off. Americans weren't quite used to it. Expect somebody to tell him at a time. Anyway, that was how Boba Fett. That depends. It depends. If we speak to other artists, we'll probably tell you that the producer's voice kind of gets near to the publishing day. but that is only because we're creative people and we've lots of things to do. But no, I'll tell you the most frames, Judge Dredd frames I did in a day was 21. It was three pages that I did. But that's like the finished pencil. But one time I was doing, because they asked me to do Old Trooper and Dredd at the same time. And I was doing 6 pages of Dredd and 3 a row in the week. I just had my two little boys at the time. We were three musketeers. We lived in Glasgow. And when I went in bed at night, I used to sit and get the work done. Now in the morning, the oldest one, he'd go and get the rolls. Really working. It was great. but I've never, as far as I can recall, never let him be down on a deadline day. I can't remember. I don't think so. But, you see, depending on what was involved in the Star Wars page, like one of these full page with tons of equipment and smashed vehicles and things, I could probably do that in about, well, end of the morning into the afternoon, maybe about, I don't know, 5-6 hours. Just depends. Sometimes it was really, go really, really fast. And you can go on a roll. And you really can't stop, just, and that's when you shouldn't stop, you just keep carrying on, because it does peter out, but you look down a hell of a lot of
is
this the Evening Times you're talking about?
Sorry.
No, well, the paper is exactly the same as what the pens, the pencils, and the brushes is. It's what you find to like. And it was probably, at that time, it was probably Saunders Waterford watercolour paper, £360 pressure. And I just found that so good. I did a lot of Star Wars on that, actually. And then it's got a slight tooth for working, and it takes watercolors. It doesn't buckle. Just superb. I like mix. Style of well, I like Mobius. I liked Philippe Dubuyer, he was in French. An older fella called Joe Kubert. He's got two sons, Andy and someone. It's not Eamon. They're in comics. I like Joe Kubert's stuff. I used to get his comics in CD bookshops in Glasgow when I was young. I used to walk from the south side away into the shop, the Old Street or something, in a couple of bookshops. And then I didn't discover, somebody must have told me that a lot of these magazines were like Stag and other things, and it was great covers for myself. Half-clad blondes with a pilot on the plane of the sinking, on the wing of the sinking plane, you know. Absolutely, yeah, it was just brilliant artwork. And what they did, when they sent these to America, they wrapped them in comic books as a bulk, as protection. So you had all these comics that the guy they did at the counter. And I used to get them, and that's where I got a Sergeant Rock. Which my mother gave away to a wee boy at the door when I went to live in London. Where's my Sergeant Rock? I'm like, you're a tenant boy, you're doing. Because they were older ones that told me about, you know.